Hey everyone, welcome to another installment of International Business TV. This evening we are going to be discussing a very interesting subject, and it's bundles, how to create an effective bundle and how to profit from these bundles. Now, as usual, we want to get a check-in from the chat room. Is everyone hearing me okay? Diane, John, Patricia, Eddie, Annette, Bob, how are you? Is everyone hearing me okay? Sounds good. Excellent, excellent. So we have today our special guest with us is Deborah Conrad from Thrifting for Profit. And as was mentioned earlier, we're going to be talking about bundles and, you know, how to create effective bundles. But we were talking earlier, and what we wanted to start on was we're going to, you know, get an introduction from Deborah, who she is. And after that, we will just explain the differences between the actual bundle and a multi-pack. But before we do that, we want to introduce Deborah Conrad to our show. Welcome, Deborah. Thank you for taking the time to come and talk with us and talk with the audience about this. You know, everybody asked about this topic. This is something, when are you going to be talking about bundles? Okay, let's find an expert and let's bring her on. So here we are, Deborah. Go ahead and introduce yourself to everyone.
Hi, I'm glad to be here. I hope everyone can hear me okay. Looks like we have a full chat room today, so I try not to watch the comments because yeah. I get distracted. So in case somebody just happens to be on here and doesn't know who I am Deborah Conrad from Thrifting for Profit. And there goes Barrington, so I'll just keep talking. And I have a podcast every week on Fridays, thriftingforprofit.com/listen is how you get there. It's on Friday afternoons, Eastern Time, at 2, I think, Eastern Time. And it used to be about a year or so more ago when I first started out with Beth, we talked strictly about thrifting, but now we talk about everything, everything related to Amazon. And I'm very much the sky is not falling kind of person.
Right.
So let's figure out the solutions. Let's not focus on the sky is falling.
And, you know, that's the same attitude that I have, Deborah, you know. The sky's not falling, so let's try to figure out a solution. I mean, things have happened. Person's account are banned. You get, you know, persons get, oh, well, you can't sell frozen anymore. What do you do? Are you going to go home and cry? No, you're going to figure out a way to make things happen. And that's what we thrive on as entrepreneurs. We have to find solutions. We have to have multiple income streams so that at the end of the day, one account is down, maybe we can sell on other platforms, maybe we can pick while we're figuring out a way to try to get to Amazon, because Amazon is not always so clear on the rules, but they're clear on, hey, we're going to shut your account down. They're clear on that. So, you know, that's the great thing.
They'll pull the trigger on you real fast, it seems like, and shut you down. Usually there's something, you know, has been going on. Oops, something that has been going on that has been an indicator, but yeah. So, and you know, the whole gated category thing, it didn't, you know, end up being such a big deal as it started out to be. So, yeah, I try not to jump in and be the voice of doom and gloom. We try to be the voice of let's figure out the solution, right?
Yeah, but how did you handle that when, you know, everybody came to you, Deborah, we have to get approved for these categories now. How did you handle that? What would, you know, your thoughts or, you know, I know persons came on this your podcast and that's all they were talking about. So how did you handle that?
Well, we didn't address it on the podcast. We actually would not address it in the podcast because we didn't have the solution. And so rather than bring it up on something that sticks around for, you know, however long years people could be listening to it, we didn't bring that up. We talked a little bit about it in the Facebook group and wait and see. Amazon is usually they will shoot something out and the bomb will drop, and everybody has the doom and gloom, sky's falling. And within a week, everything usually shakes out, and everybody's kind of figured out how to address the problem, and then we go forward. And now we know the answer. We know the answers that we didn't know when they first come out, because you can't just contact them and get a straight answer. No. You know that. You'll talk to a different person every time, and it'll be a different answer.
I found that out. Sometimes you call, you know, sometimes when you send a message in the chat, or, you know, you get one answer, and what do? I call back, write back, and somebody gives you a totally different answer. So again, you know, everyone, if you have a situation, just, you know, give it some time and patiently wait on Amazon and see where they're going with it. Now, down into our main topic, the first thing we wanted to do was discuss the differences between what is a multi-pack and what is a bundle. So Deborah, if you can just shed some light on that topic for us, what is a multi-pack and what is classified as a bundle?
Yeah, Barrington and I were talking earlier today about that there's still confusion. And I know I've tripped over the words and called a multi-pack a bundle and a bundle a multi-pack. But a multi-pack is two or more of the same, exactly, the same UPC, the same product. So if you have, you're selling a mouse and you want to sell two of them, it's the same. You would have two of these in the same bag, or three or four or whatever. And a bundle would be the mouse and the mouse pad.
Right.
Two different things.
Right. So I've had tons of questions on that. It's, for me, you know, I look at, you know, multi-packs are, I have one SKU, and I want to, you know, offer a more competitive rate, so I now add a second. It's the same SKU. I add a second, so now I have a two-pack. Amazon usually puts that nice little swish on there. It says two-pack. There you go. That is what you call a multi-pack. But as you mentioned, a bundle is where you add value to the customer. You're thinking, now this person is going to be baking. Maybe they want the actual, you know, baking pan or baking dish, whatever you call it, along with, you know, the actual flour to bake or something that's related, but it has to add value to the customer. Based on Amazon's policy, this bundle has to add value to your customer.
Value.
And that is the key.
It doesn't mean it's there's been confusion, obviously, by some of the questionable bundles I've seen, that it doesn't mean to go out and pick up a pack of stickers and say, I'm going to add stickers to this blender or something. It doesn't add any value. And I foresee that Amazon is going to have an issue with this. In a Spreecast I watched, it's been probably 3 or 4 months ago, I don't remember whose it was, and they were talking about some products that people were putting things together, that it was like a main product that's a really good seller, and they would go to the dollar store and find dollar store things that kind of went with it and just throw it in there to make it a unique bundle, and it really didn't add any value. It was not a value proposition.
Right.
And it doesn't necessarily mean also that you have to go completely with frequently bought together things. It's a lot of testing, don't you think? It's a lot of testing.
And I was just about to allude to that point. It's, you could create a bundle that maybe it's not going so well. You're not getting any sales, and you're wondering, you know, I'm not getting any sales. Maybe you ran a few product ads. We're going to talk about product ads a little bit later on. And maybe, you know, but in about 35 minutes into the show, we're going to take some questions. But you're running the product ads and you're thinking, it's not effective. What's going on? I'm not getting, you know, buys off it or anything. Maybe you need to think about, would something else be more effective for this bundle, which would make it sell much more? And my thought process for a bundle is always, you know, like for someone who, you know, they cook a lot, so they know what happens in the kitchen. Think about it from your perspective. If you're going to prepare a meal and you're thinking, okay, I need to have, this is, I bought some, you know, a rack of lamb or whatever I'm going to prepare, some ribs. What do you need to make it happen? You know, what kind of spices would you need? You know, think about the things that you would need to make that dish happen. And from there, you can start to get creative ideas on how to create a bundle, because you're like, I can't do it without this Mrs. Dash seasoning and maybe something else and something else. And then you start to get creative. Then you start to really get creative when you, you know, bundle different things, but they must add value to the customer. Amazon always talks about that. Thanks, Bob, for posting that bundling policy in there. What has been some of your most effective bundles, though, Deborah?
I've done very well with ones that are related to gifts. I always talk about that I do gift baskets without the basket because I don't want. There's some very good sellers on Amazon that do gift baskets, and that's their profession, and they do it very well. But I do it in a different way, so that it's easier to ship and it's a little more creative. And I'm not, I learned early on that bundles, I started creating bundles with things that I couldn't get it easily get my hands on again and again. And that was a big mistake, very big mistake. Because it takes time to think of your bundles. It takes time and effort. And if you're going to put that effort in and create that product page and get those good images and research your keywords and do your bullet points and do your description and put it together so it's easy to ship and it's profitable and all that, don't you want something that's going to last for a year or two or more?
You definitely want that. Yep. You definitely want something that's going to be, you know, longevity, not something that's going to be, it's a seasonal stuff. It's hard and I can't find this anymore. You definitely. So guys, again, I always talk about taking action. And if you were listening carefully to what Deborah was saying a while ago, you would pick up two great bullet points as to what you need to do. She's looking at gift items. Now, for the chat room, give us what you think would be a wonderful bundle for this week or last week in terms of coming up this week or last week. What would you think? I want to see if your creative juices are flowing. What would be a great item to bundle, or you know, what products do you think would go well now for last week and this week? There's a holiday coming up, or not really a holiday, but just, you know, an actual.
It's a holiday.
Time. Well, it's a holiday. So
it's a what holiday.
What do you think would go well? Let's see if anybody in the chat room is really thinking, and, you know, what do you think would go well? Just put your answers right in the chat room.
I did one last year, not this year, but last year.
There you go.
It did really well. I'm gonna let them talk about this. What kinds of things would you? Yeah, grilling.
There you go.
Power drills, barbecue, yeah. Grill. Okay. What about here's one that's gonna kind of get you thinking a little bit. What about beer? Okay, you can't sell alcohol, so how do you do beer? Because you know, lots of people are looking for things not just to do with barbecues, but they're looking for things that have to do with beer. And so I did a bundle that had beer bread mix. It had, I can't remember everything it had in it, but it had one of those. Oh, it had one of those. It's a metal. A metal stand to turn your chicken in, put the beer can up in the chicken to barbecue it. I forgot what they're called. But so then I wrote up, I did beer nuts, and I did, I had those toy sunglasses that look like beer mugs. I put those in there. So it was a party in a box. And then I also wrote up the instructions for using the beer holder thingy for the chicken, whatever it was. So, and they were my own instructions. So It would be pretty hard to copy that and impossible because what I included was copyrighted material.
There you go.
So, now,
ideas, flowing the ideas. Hey, Karen, yeah, good. For me, if I'm on this freecast right now, I'm writing down some notes. I'm taking some notes because the key thing is don't just come listen on this freecast. Take action. She's giving you actionable points right here that you could use all day long to actually make big profits using bundles. Why? You found a product, you're happy. You listed this product and you're like, yeah, I'm making good sales. But then guess what? 45 sellers jump on the listing. What do? You know the product is good. You know you can sell it. You know it's a fast seller. What do? Figure out how to create an effective bundle.
Something that's... Do you know, Barrington, when people talk about having repricers all the time? So that they can reprice their products to keep their products in the buy box.
Right.
Well, I don't use a repricer, and pretty much all year long I don't worry about it except at Christmas time when I'm doing toys and I'm really jumping into the competition, then I worry about it. The rest of the year I always have the buy box with these products because I don't have any competition.
Yeah.
So
love it, love it, love it, love it. Because you know what? That's the biggest thing for Amazon sellers. I don't have the buy box. I need to go run a product ad because I don't have the buy box. When you create unique, really unique bundles, you don't need to worry about that. You always have the buy box. And guess what that translates into? More sales. Your sell-through rate is going. And then if you can create effective bundles and capitalize on the seasons, like now, tomorrow is the Soccer World Cup. It starts tomorrow, and that's going to be huge. That's billions of people watching that. What can you create that you can capitalize on the rush that's going to happen now for jerseys, for soccer hats, for caps, or what can you do to capitalize on that? Remember, you're talking about over 2 billion people that are going to be actively watching these games and they're fanatic about soccer. What can you do to actually make this happen? Q4, Father's Day. You have to think ahead. Think, you know, how can I capitalize on this? And if you get one bundle going, if you get your pictures right, your bullet points, your, you know, keywords, it's going to be so infectious that you're just always going to be looking for a creative way to do your next bundle. I can guarantee
you. Now, one point I want to make, Barrington, about, we were just talking about Father's Day, mm-hmm. you know, that this, but that bundle doesn't say Father's Day. So anybody, it's an all year long thing. So I might sell more at Father's Day and Christmas, mm-hmm. holidays, but it would sell all year long because it's a gift for a man, right? So your keywords would say men's birthday, you know, in your keywords, you know, guy birthday gift, beer gift, you know, all those kinds of things. So a couple questions that I didn't want you to miss was the one about copyright and the one about merchant fulfill.
Right. So they have them in there. So we're gonna get to those, you know, questions.
I'm in there? Okay.
Yeah, we're going to get to those. We're just putting them in. Are they in the queue? Okay.
They're in the chat room.
Okay.
I haven't even looked at the
queue. If you can put them on the screen queue, that would be very, very helpful because at the end of the day, we're going to, about 30 minutes in, we're going to start to take your questions. But, you know, some great points that Deborah just made regarding things that you can do for bundling. And if you actually put some of these into action, you will start to see sales. And the biggest fear, again, fear of losing the buy box because you're competing with everybody, Amazon and everybody else. But get these creative bundles going. Now, you know, some persons will say, oh, well, you know, I have my bundle. And, you know, I would love to get it listed. I wanted to ask you, is there any service that does that? Is there any service out there that says, okay, I have my pictures and I want to be able to, you know, get effective listings going. Is there any service that you know of that's actually out there that does that?
Not at this time, no. Not that I know of. I think that there might be some virtual assistants. People have virtual assistants that they have trained to do this.
Okay.
But I'm not, I don't know as there's a service for this. Good point, though.
There you go, chat room. Business idea. Business idea. I'm always thinking outside the box. There you go. That's a business idea. If you can figure out
right there
how to do this, how to create an effective listing for persons, then this can really mean the difference in your business. I was just talking to Deborah before we came on. My wife listed a multi-pack and about 2-3 days ago. And today we got about $515 or $520 in sales from one person, and it's going to Portugal. It's going to Portugal. Can you believe that? It's going to Portugal. And I'm thinking, wow, one order, $520 on one order going to Portugal. That was, you know, the multi-pack.
Did they buy that?
Sorry, go ahead.
Did they buy that on the UK site?
Nope, US site. On the
US site, and it's going to Portugal.
Going to Portugal, because I saw the order and I'm like, oh wow, this is nice. $515 on one order, that's great. And then I'm thinking, then my wife called me and said, do you see where the order is going? And I'm like, no, it's going to the US, right? No, look at it. Oh, Portugal. Wow, people are finding it. And that's because FBA export is turned on our web store. So persons are able to take advantage of that. They can buy and it's shipped to wherever in the world. So again, take advantage of multi-packs. And I've seen that Amazon, you know, in terms of the multi-packs, they've gotten a little stricter on it. Now, it's not so easy to do like, okay, I'm just going to create a multi-pack out there. But for persons who are wondering how difficult this is, you know, in terms of creating a bundle, I think we paid $25 for 1,000 UPCs. 1,000 UPCs. Now, in creating the bundle, Deborah, what should persons take into consideration? When you're getting ready to
You have to buy, well, you have to buy your UPCs. You're going to need something to bag them in. You need to know how to create a product page. You need to know how to take pictures.
Good pictures.
You need to know how to do that. You need to know how to do good pictures before. We've all seen terrible pictures, and it's not going to help you sell your product, that's for sure. Keeping things in mind, like the size of the products. If you're bundling things together, it's going to start adding up weight-wise. And so you need to make sure you know how much things are going to weigh all in one package, because weight can pay a considerable amount of your fees if you're not careful.
Key. That's key. So again, guys, there are some points. We're going to highlight them again. You know, your pictures, key. There are services out there like Pixlr that can take out the background. And, you know, let me see if I can put that in the chat room. Pixlr. This does a very good job at removing the background. So, that's one service that does, you know, remove the background of your pictures. You need to, it's a thought process. You need to think about what you're going to do. How am I going to create this bundle? Think about your client. Think about who you're going to sell this product to. What's their thought process when they're going out there and looking for something? And then your bullet points should highlight the major things of your bundle. The major highlight point or bullet points for your bundle should be stating why. I'm a customer. I'm browsing your listing. Tell me why I should buy from you. Tell me why I should buy this product. That's going to be the key indicators in your bullet points. So those are things that you want to, you know, there's another site, PhotoFuse. There's another site that's going to, you know, it's key to ensure that. So to get this done, you have to do, it's a planning phase. Okay, I'm planning. Okay, I need pictures. I need my bullet points. I need what keywords are going to do well. What keywords are going to bring my listing? And then after that, if you need to give your listing some jumpstart, then product ads may be something that you can look into to get some traffic going to your actual ads. And that will help you to get some traction, because you remember, you're not going to have a sales rank. There's going to be no sales rank on it to start, but creative ways. If persons are, you know, you have friends and family and they may say, okay, well, you know, purchase and give me, and your honest feedback. purchase, do a purchase and give me on. Maybe you can use a coupon, a discount code or something that will get traction to your product and get your product start going. But once you have traction, once you get that sales rank, people start to see it and they start to buy, that's the time that you're going to have to start figuring out and buying bundles. One question I wanted to ask you was, what has been one of your more unique bundles, you know, where it's just not anything that anybody can just go and pick up and put together? And, you know, why would you always use that strategy where you make it exclusive where, you know, no one else can really duplicate it that easily?
I think I talked about this before in a different podcast or screencast or something. I did Valentine's bundles, and they were actually a gift, a box. And now all of my bundles are not gifts. I have to just qualify that. I do a lot of things that are just two products. One is the product, and the other one is the box to hold the product. And I'll just bundle those together, and they're very easy. I do a lot of stuff from wholesalers. But most of these that I'm talking about right now are things that I bought retail stuff and put together. And so I did a Valentine's related bundle, and then I decided it did really well at Valentine's Day, not this year, but the year before. It did very well at Valentine's Day, and then I reworked it because after Valentine's Day, nobody's looking for a Valentine's Day gift. So then I turned it into just an anniversary gift. And it was, do you know what s'mores are, Barrington? The chocolate and the marshmallows and the graham crackers. Do you know what that is?
I've seen them. I haven't had them before, but I've seen them in the stores. Okay. Yes.
Mm-hmm. I didn't know of Jamaica, but I'm sure you know, those of us that live in the U.S. know that, you know, you roast the marshmallows, you put it on graham crackers with chocolate. So I called it, it was a s'more something. I can't remember. It was very, very cute title. But it was around s'mores, and I did dark chocolate. Instead of regular milk chocolate, I did Hershey's dark chocolate, the graham crackers, the strawberry-flavored marshmallows, mm-hmm. One of the sticks that you use that's made out of wire was bent to fit in the box, and I did... special napkins, and I created an invitation for whoever got the box to invite their significant other to share s'mores with them, and which is kind of an event, a little event. Yeah. So I had a little invitation in there, and then I also included a, there you go, that's
there
it. Then I included a small frame. It was a dollar store frame, and so that they could take a picture and capture the memory, and so it was a memory maker. The whole idea behind it and my bullet points and everything was creating a memory around Valentine's Day or creating a memory around anniversary, and it was something to do together that was different than going out to dinner in a movie or something like that. So I just created this event, and
love it.
It was pretty popular.
Love
it was pretty popular. Yeah. Here's the whole deal. So I spent a lot of time thinking about it, creating it, doing the right pictures. And when I want to talk a little bit just for 2 seconds about pictures, when you're thinking about doing a bundle and you're going to have a lot of ingredients, you need to learn how to take pictures of a lot of ingredients all in one spot. It's not as easy as it sounds. Don't just throw them up there and say, oh, that's great. So make it interesting looking to the people who are going to be looking at this, a whole idea. So and now these kinds of things are listed in the because they were it was made with groceries, it's listed in the grocery category.
Right.
So and gourmet foods or whatever. And actually it's actually listed as a gift basket, although I don't do baskets. So, right.
You know, I just love your creativity. It's just contagious. I love your creativity because you're just talking and talking with you is giving me ideas, and I'm thinking, I could do that on something else. that's what you come on these free casts, you get this information, but then put it to action. Just one point. Just create one bundle. That's all you need. One bundle. See, Donald also made a good point. These pictures need to be at least 1,000 by 1,000 pixel size. So there you go. Again, create, and then the service, I'm throwing it out there. Anyone that's out there that's on this free cast, I'm putting on the challenge. Get a service going. That could be something that you charge people to make it happen, because people want to create these bundles. It's kind of overwhelming. How do I get this thing done? I don't know how to do this. That's always the issue. It's easier to list on the single, but then you complain when you have competition. So always, always, always try to think outside of what the other guy's doing. A lot of people are not going to even try to compete with you. We're at the 30-minute mark. And
sorry, two more things. One is, once you create the bundle, try to think of things that are fairly similar. I mean, like, say you were doing something for Valentine's and St. Patrick's Day and Father's Day or whatever, so that your packaging, your size, your everything is kind of similar. So when you're doing your listings, you can do sell almost like on eBay, sell similar. It's, you know, you can do similar bullet points, similar description, everything. The other thing I want to mention, I just want to say, is it takes some work and effort to create bundles. The more you do it, the easier it gets. The beauty is that you put in that effort, and then if it's a good seller, you can continue to sell it, especially if you do things where people can't jump in and copy it. Then you can continue to sell those for a very long time without having to think. You just order the parts and put it in a box and ship it off. So it takes a little more effort than buying a toy and shipping it in. It takes a little more effort. I like not having competition, and I like the creative aspect of it.
Right. Great. Me too. Who wants all that competition? Nobody wants all that competition. You want to be unique, and you want to have that buy box. It's such a good feeling, Deborah, isn't it? When you go into and you're looking at your sales report and it says, you know, percentage of the buy box, 100. That's just
100. Yeah.
100. That's a good feeling, because, you know, if someone came to this listing and they're going to make a purchase, I will be the one receiving that money. So at the end of the day, it's great, and it's a good way to, you know, separate from the pack. I always tell people that it's a good way to separate from the pack. Now, we have a ton of questions in here, and I see one question had 9 votes. That means everybody wants to get this question answered. And that's the first one here, from Carrie Collier. How do you increase the rank for a new bundle? And I guess that's just one of the biggest questions out there. I made this bundle. It's nice. Have great pictures, bullet points. How do you really increase the rank for this new bundle? Get persons looking at it. What are your keys?
Okay, I think that you probably do maybe some advertising, or maybe some get other people to buy them. Mm-hmm. Do you do that?
For me, it's the first thing on that is product ads. That's the first way I'm going to get it, because, you know, it's a new bundle and you may not get that sale instantly. So the first thing for me is, let's do some product ads. It's only 5 cents to advertise that product. What Amazon will do is they will put your product along with similar items. So if it's in grocery, if it's in toys, wherever, they're going to put your item along with similar items in the same category. And then persons coming down, they're like, interesting. I'm seeing a single pack of this one, but I have a bundle here. Once you get that purchase of, like, for example, we introduced a new product in the UK. And we had, it was, you know, not getting too much traffic. We know it's a good seller in the US. So we're not getting too much traffic. First thing we did, created a product. I just go and create a campaign. I'm going to do a video for that. Create a campaign. And once you get that campaign going, it's five. We paid 5 pence per click. And in a week, we sold £875 worth of items, and our ad spend was £7.04, or 45 pence, something like that. So for £7, I'm making almost £1,000 in sales. I'm going to do that all day long. Same thing with items that are listed on the .com. You can use Amazon product ads. Another thing is, maybe it's going to be expensive. You set your budget, $5 a day. Do not exceed $5 per day. So that's the minimum that Amazon will do, $5 a day. That's it. If you're spending $20 not making any sales, so 4 days pass, you've hit the maximum. A lot of times you don't hit the maximum, but you're not getting any sales. Okay, well, I need to revamp. I've never had it go further than, under $20. And then once you get that sale, your item starts to, it goes off on its own. It's like it's a baby, it's creeping. Once you get those sales and it gets the sales rank, it's off and running. You don't need to even do that anymore because it's going to be listed when they search for everything else. Another thing, keywords. You have to have keywords. The right keywords in there because that's what persons are going to be searching for. That's what they're going to be searching for. So when you
and you're not talking just about keywords in your product listing. You're talking about keywords. Really, really know how to research keywords for your ad so that it's getting in all the right places. Yeah.
Right. So it gets that traffic. And the key thing, when you're using those keywords, Amazon gives you a list. Okay, based on what you're, listing, we will suggest blah, 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 blah. But also, as she mentioned earlier, Deborah just mentioned, you have to find keywords that are going to pull your ads. That's the key, having those keywords. So maybe you use a tool like, the Google keyword tool. I think it's, the Google keyword tool, just get ideas. And also another way to get ideas is when you go in the search bar and you start typing for your product, are the recommended searches? That's key.
Always use those. Always use those first. Yeah.
Always use those first. So Carrie, I hope you were able to, shed some light on that. And, you can jump in and go ahead and try that out. Let me know how it works. Take action. Let me know how it works. Let's see. The next question in there from Jason was, for keywords, do you put more than one comma separated keyword phrase per line? You want to take that or you want me to take it?
I use as many keywords with a comma as I can.
Yep. I was about to tell you that.
And phrases.
Yeah. Phrases and commas. So whatever it is, I'm going to put that phrase, comma, put that phrase again, comma. So however many I can
only
find.
Let you. Yeah.
Yeah.
In your product descriptions, it only lets you go so far. So it's you got to, get the best you can in there. And because you can always change them. You can always go in and change them.
Right.
So
you can always go in there and change them.
But I think with ads, you can use as many as you want, can't you?
Yeah. You have a whole string of those keywords you can drop in there. Yeah. So if you go to the Google Keyword Planner and you find others, bring them in there, drop them in there but I think the most effective ones are the ones when you start to type and it starts to display those keywords. Those are the most effective because Amazon is telling you when persons are searching for products with this name, these are what these are the search terms that they, usually use.
You can use. And Google a lot of times does the same thing. You start typing things in just in Google search and it starts coming down with some suggestions. So look to see what they have on plain old Google search. So,
Google. Charles Roberts had the next question. Is it important to make your bundles cost over $35 to make them eligible for Prime shipping? Everybody's worried about that. What's your take on that?
Nope. I want to keep my bundles at 35 or more, if I can, but not specifically for Prime shipping. It's just because I'm trying to get my average selling price up there. But I think when the prices, I think that the magic 25 that I talked about for so long, and now, then they changed it to $35 minimum for Prime shipping. I'm not sure that has held true. I think that $25, the difference between $24.99 and $25 was a big deal. The difference between $34.99 and $35, maybe not such a big deal. But if you are close to $35, in your product bundle at $33.99, I would bump it over $35 every day. Every just day. Because I think you'll get more people, especially if they're buying, they're on there, they're not buying a lot of stuff, they're just looking for one gift and they want that prime ship, that free shipping. Let's get it to 35, not prime, but whatever the free shipping thing is.
That's a good way. I mean, you want to get it there so persons can be like, oh, okay, qualified. You want to, I mean, if you have a bundle and it's a bundle, so it should already be, you know, the value should be going up. And, you know, you want persons to look and say, okay, I can get this next day. Cool, boom, click, done. They are going to make those purchases all day long. So great question, man. How do you copyright your material? How do you copyright your material? Cost?
Copyright, if you write something in a blog post or whatever, it's copyrighted. It's copyright protected. So there is no, it's not, it doesn't have anything to do with trademark. It doesn't have anything to do with registration or anything like that. It's just the laws now are that, and it wasn't always this way, but the laws now are that if you write something, it's yours and it is copyrighted. You don't have to, you can say stuff like at the bottom of websites and stuff, I'll say copyright, you know, protected, but it's always copyright protected. Doesn't mean that people don't steal it, but when you are on Amazon and you have a product that has something in it that you created and somebody comes in, which we've seen several times so far with some of our people, was that they have a product, but the little comment box that the other person used was, well, I have the same thing, but mine doesn't have the article. It's the same, it just doesn't have the article. Well, then you can contact Amazon and they'll remove it.
Yeah, violation. Yep, that will be in violation. So that's a good
way. It's a violation.
Yep, and that makes you unique. That's you. You wrote something in there and that's your content. It came from your brain. That's unique. So you can bring, if somebody else has the same items, but that's not in there, then hey,
that's right.
That's a violation according to Amazon's policy. All right.
And I didn't just use, I have it, it isn't just content that I've used. I don't know how many people on here know, but I'm a public domain expert and I use public domain images to create products, things that go with products. So I use a lot of images and they're public domain images, but I will change them. But it still could be considered public domain, so I don't really have copyright protection on them. But let me tell you, 99.9999% of the people aren't going to go to the effort I did to create that and put that in there. They could if they thought about it, but they probably aren't going to. So I'm pretty well protected. And it's the best feeling in the world to be able to contact Amazon and say, don't think they have that. A bundle created properly. I'm pretty sure that they can't do this. So then, and you can have, and then you're back to the only person who sells this. I love that.
Best feeling in the world. You just got the best feeling in the world because guess what? You can contact Amazon with confidence. They don't have it.
Yes.
You can confidently say, because that's your bundle. You create.
Yeah, one of the few areas you can feel under control on Amazon.
This is mine. It's my product.
It's mine.
I'm telling you, Eddie had a question. You know, we were talking about this earlier, Debbie, and the new rules of creating bundles and multi-packs.
There aren't any new rules. There's old rules. There's old rules that are for multi-packs that are now being enforced, which is making it very difficult for us to create multi-packs in health and beauty and grocery and that kind of stuff. I still create multi-packs all the time in other categories. So, but there are no new rules for bundles.
Yeah, that's it. Until Amazon tells you directly, okay, here are the new rules, and they come up with that policy. We just follow what is there in the actual.
I follow the rules that they have right now. They will probably, my prediction is that, I don't know when, someday, someday in the future that they're going to come down and have some changes to their bundling policy, and we won't know what that's going to be till it happens, and then we'll figure out what to do different. And I think that doing bundle, and I have a feeling that it might be like the those of us that were already grandfathered for health and beauty and groceries and all of that, that it might be that we're grandfathered in because we're doing okay with bundles. We haven't had any violations. They haven't found any problems. We haven't been doing anything with hazmat. And so I'm thinking that those of us that have been doing bundles, that when they come out with something like this, that it won't be so much of an issue as it will be for new people. So I encourage you to do bundles. And bundles in the summertime, when you're not all crazy with the holidays that are coming up, perfect time to learn how to do bundles and get them in and get them tested so that you're ready for massive sales in the wintertime, in the holiday Woo! Season.
Q4. Woo! Massive sales in Q4.
Massive sales in Q4.
Everybody wants, you know, this is another question that everybody would ask. What would your markup like on your bundles? Approximate, you know, what are your markups on bundles?
Oh boy. Well, way higher than retail arbitrage. all I can say is that when you're creating bundles, you have to consider all of your costs, your bags, your boxes, your labels, your UPC codes, you know, whatever, all of that stuff. You figure it all out. How much is it going to cost me to send it to Amazon if it weighs? I mean, I have bundles that weigh 10 pounds, so that could cost me $8 to send to Amazon. I've got to consider all of that. How's that going to affect the pricing? What kind of products am I competing with on Amazon? And then say, can I at least double my money? I never sell a bundle that I'm not doubling my money. And I don't have to worry about dropping prices. So if that's the price it's going to be. And if it sells at that price, if it sells really fast at that price, I start going up. How often do you hear that the ability to do that with anything? I raise my prices on stuff, sometimes $1, sometimes $10 at a time, depending. I sell bundles that are $150 a piece. So not a lot and not super fast, because $150 a piece is not going to sell. But let me tell you, I have every holiday season that I've sold them, I've never had enough in. I've never had enough in. It's a big investment, but I've always sold out way too soon.
I mean, this is great information.
Yeah.
This is absolutely, everybody, the questions are just coming in because everybody's just like, wow, you $150, you don't have to worry about competition. And if it sells, you can actually raise the prices? What?
You're starting to raise the price.
Do you merchant fulfill or FBA all of your bundles?
I do everything FBA. I do some. The only thing I merchant fulfill is toys during the holiday time, right? For about 2 weeks, end of November, beginning of December. Just, I think you said that on the last free, your last freecast. Do it for about 2 weeks and then I'm done.
The good thing about this is, you know, those last 2 weeks, well, I'm like the 13th or the 14th. I'm sold out. Everything is done. But the customers are looking for the products. What do? You know, I can get them. I have them in hand. Guess what? If I try to send these into FBA, it's not going to get there in time to be checked on and received and then shipped back to the customer. So guess what? Send it directly to the customer. Get those orders in. Print. Packing slip goes in the box. Send. You know, the good thing is I always try to, you know, be in the U.S. like closer to the end of the year. Because I can just run to the UPS store, running to the store, pack, boom, everything goes out. Love it. I absolutely love it. Now, Asad had a question. Do we need a new UPC for multi-pack, or can we use the existing UPC on Amazon? I can take
for
this
multi-packs?
One.
Yeah, you take that one.
For multi-packs, yes. Because if you have a UPC on the single, and then you're going to list two of the same items, Amazon wants you to have a new UPC code for that multi-pack. I can tell you that because they're going to say UPC already existing. What are you, you know, you're listing a product that's already on the database. It's already here. So it's $25 for 1,000. That's a business investment. That's a business write-off. You know, $25 for 1,000, I don't think you're going to be using 1,000 anytime soon. So yes, you do need a new UPC for your bundle. So if it's a 2-pack, a 3-pack, a 6-pack, a 12-pack, that's going to be, and the good thing is you can pull all of those together. So when someone comes to the listing, they're seeing all their options on one page. So that's a good way. Kathy, she had a good question. Can you generally make money on bundles that are bought at retail price? I can think of items to combine, but they are at non-sale prices. I don't know that the profit would be high enough. What do you think on that one? What's your take on that, Debra?
Made a lot of bundles from retail arbitrage stuff, but I always try to create the bundles with things, keeping in mind how much I'm going to have to pay at its highest retail price. And then if I find it on sale, I just made more money. But I create the bundles that are made from retail arbitrage, from things that I can find. That's the thing I learned. The first bundling things I did were I made things that were not replenishable. I made great bundles, but I couldn't find, and it has to be, you can't substitute in a bundle. You can't say, oh, well, now I'm going to put in, instead of making it with the Hershey chocolate, I'm going to make it with Reese's Pieces or something like that. You can't do that. You've got to keep it consistent. Delete that bundle and start over.
There you go.
I deleted a lot of bundles.
Use one of your 1,000 UPCs. Now, I know persons have a lot of questions. It looks like I have to bring Debra, you know, back on another Spreecast because we have a ton of questions. Not sure if we're going to get through all the questions, but Debra has put together all of this. It might seem overwhelming, you know, now, but she has put together a step-by-step guide that will guide you through the basics of bundling. What you need to do, you know, as you mentioned earlier, your thought process in terms of
planning. And all my mistakes. I put all my mistakes in there.
Tell us a little bit more about your the product you put together for persons who are, you know, thinking about getting into bundling, you know, and want to do this right.
I have been bundling almost since I started a little over 3 years ago. I've been not even realizing that it was called bundling. I mean, I didn't even read all the rules. So I just learned that you could do this and started putting it together. And I have made a lot of different mistakes, and I describe them in this guide. I go through and kind of describe them, and I really talk more about the creative aspect and how I created the ones that are different, and I show you some examples of them, like the Valentine one and that kind of thing, and really get you thinking about there's a lot of people that they just want to walk into the store and say, here's a cake mix, here's a cake pan, here's the frosting, there's a bundle. And my theory is that's too easy to copy.
Right.
It's too easy to copy. It takes just a tiny little bit more effort to create something a little more creative that somebody can't copy. I've also got bundles, like I said, where I have one little product and I have the box, a container that it goes in. And it actually wouldn't be that hard for somebody to copy, but the containers are not exactly how it's shown in the picture, are not that easy to find. It's not like you can go to Walmart and find them. So, but I know where to find them, and somebody else could probably figure it out, you know, if they really went down the rabbit trail. But it's just two things. But it's a unique bundle. It's all mine. A very similar product sells for $9.99. Mine sells for $14.99 all the time, and I don't have any competition.
There you go. That's the key. So, I mean, the link is above, so you guys can look at the guide. It's bundling basics. Sorry, Deborah, you were saying something.
There it is, right there. Edie was saying, when I was talking about starting out and then raising the prices, they said, start out high. Well, start out high. Well, I did start out high. I started out as high as I thought anybody would pay, thinking that, well, I could come down a little bit if they didn't sell. But they started selling, and so I bumped them up 10 bucks. And then and then they were still selling. I bumped them up 10 bucks again, and now they were $189, and the sales stopped. So then I had to come back down. So you do that kind of testing. Yeah.
And I always talk about it. The key, test. Always test. Look at what price is. Okay, is it selling optimally at $55, or maybe I could get another $5, because you're creating a bundle. You're actually solving a problem for your buyer. There you go. Right. Okay, well, I can get all of this in one place. I don't have to go search here. God, this person read my mind. And then those bullet points should jump out at you. Why should I buy your bundle? That's what you're telling your buyer in the bullet point. Right. And, you know, I love Deborah's guide.
You're offering convenience, you're offering value, or you're offering something unique that nobody else has, pretty much.
Yeah, I'm telling you. Deborah, I mean, it's been so great having you on, because...
Oh, thank you so much, Barrington.
I've never seen... the chat room has lit up. You know, personally, there are so many questions. I know we can't get through all the questions today.
No.
Duane is coming up in at 8 o'clock. I know we can't get through all the questions. But guys, your questions are answered in that bundle. It's right on top here. It's the perfect starting out guide. You know, get it. And your investment in this will really take your business to the next level. Because guess what? If you can figure out how to create a unique bundle, guess what? As she said, there's no feeling like having 100% of the buy box. Do you know how good that feels? 100% of the buy box?
And be able to kick somebody else off your listing?
It just gets better with the, you know, that information. I mean, we thank you so much. I mean, let me know when you have a space. I'd love to come on your podcast and, you know, just, you know, talk
I will.
All things international. Just, you know, all things international.
Again, I have people that are excited about it. Yeah. All righty, thank you.
If you want to follow me, click on the link above. You follow Deborah. Her link is above there. And we thank her so much for coming on the podcast tonight. Guys, again, we bring you only the best. We try to get your minds going, get your thought process going. You know, we know Deborah had to jump off, but again, we probably have to get Deborah back on here, because it's bundling is just something that's really, really amazing. Hey, see you guys all in September too. Hopefully, you know, Jehovah's willing, we'll be there in September. We'll leave you with some exit music. Thank you.
you do?